Hey, there we go. Good evening and welcome to number 14, I almost forgot again, out of 16 planned sessions of our The Way of Ascent meditation project study, where we're going through the what's called the levels of the soul. And we usually do like a quick review or a different type of quick review each time. And we will do that. So each of our 4 months, so we're on the fourth and final one. We started this in February, and we took a different level of the soul each month. There are technically five levels of the soul, as they're called, or five dimensions of the soul, or levels of soul consciousness is another way that it's expressed. And these are all taken from the Torah. The fifth one, though, is not one we really get into studying and analyzing, because it's not one we, so to speak, work on like the other four, because it's the level that is more or less considered our direct attachment to God. So if you get that far, way to go. most people don't in life, but even at each level of the soul, as we'll talk about this in a minute, you address all five levels within each one of the five levels, similar to the Omer count, how you address all seven of the emanations, the midot, within each of the seven. So that's a concept called inter-inclusion. It's not even in the dictionary. It's a very Torah-based term. It's about the only place I found it. So we just went by on Monday night. That was another thing that was cool, and we mentioned this before, was that each of these 4 months happened coincidentally to have a holiday of sorts in the first week. We had the New Year for Trees in February, Tu Shavat. Then we had Purim in March, right? And Passover last month. And we just went by Lag BaOmer. And each one of these, again, coincidentally, the themes for those holidays aligned with the themes for that particular level of the soul, which are the basic awareness of Tu B'Shavat and creation, God and creation. And then struggle is our second level of Ruach, and that was with Purim, and then connection with Passover and the level of Neshama. And now we're at more of the collective concept of the body of people following Hashem, the body of Mashiach. It's called different things, but the collective group of those people that are seeking God, so to speak. And so we just went through Lag BaOmer, and one of the themes with Lag BaOmer is that it celebrates the end of a plague, and that plague was caused by a lack of unity. It was a disrespect amongst a group of students of Rabbi Akiva a couple thousand years ago, and because of that, a plague struck, and 24,000, you heard right, 24,000 students of Rabbi Akiva passed away. Oh, we got people coming in here, hold on. I got it. Okay. So it's a celebration of the end of that. So that's your unity theme. And Rabbi Akiva also, I'm sorry, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, who is a main character in the Zohar text, the mystical text of Torah. It's the remembrance of his death. And importantly, right before he died, he gave some of the deepest secrets of Torah to his inner circle of disciples, and they're recorded in a certain portion of the Zohar called the Yidra. Well, there's two Yidrot. There's one with a larger group, which is also very deep, and then there's one with a small, which is the Yidra Rabbah, and then you have the Yidra Zuta, which is the smaller one, but that's really dense and has some very deep concepts. It takes a lot of work to work on concerning our world and Mashiach and where we're heading and all this kind of stuff. So anyhow, all of that's around Lag BaOmer, a very mystical holiday, and it was at the beginning of this month. So that was pretty cool that we had a holiday at the end of each at the beginning of each month that kind of went along with stuff. This is our calendar. As you can see, we are down to the fourth month of May down there. We're at the fourth soul level of Chayah. So we went through Nefesh, Ruach, and Neshama, those three soul levels, which are the basic soul. Ruach is the soul that connects from below to above, and Neshama is the level of connection, the higher level of connection. Those three are, as we've talked about in different ways, When you talk about the first three levels of the soul, the first three worlds of existence, the first three modes of Torah study, of interpretation, the first three are always kind of like a group. They're set together. The three levels of the soul are considered within the body, the first three. And then when you get to this fourth level of the soul, you're talking about something that is outside of creation, something outside of our personal consciousness, again, more of a collective or group consciousness. This is where all souls emanate from, where we meet, so to speak. This is the level of what's called the Betzelem Elohim, the image of God that you see in Genesis chapter 1, that we are creation, that when we're created, we're made in that image. So it pre-exists creation. It's already there. When you're studying the levels of interpretation you may have heard of, you have the basic level of Peshat, and then the Remez, which is the hint. Some, you know, the verses have a hint, and then the Drash or Midrash, which is the homiletical. We're bringing concepts together, but those three are all addressing just the text itself. And then that fourth level, again, when you get outside the first three, is the Kabbalistic level, which is beyond, brings in ideas and information from beyond just the text itself. So you always have that idea of the first three being kind of a group, and then the fourth. So here we are in May, month of May, level of Chayah. As I mentioned, we look at a level of the soul within each. So when we got to the level of Chayah this month, last week we looked at the Nefesh level within Chayah, the basic level of awareness. And then we're at the Ruach level of Chayah. Ruach is the level of struggle. That's where we're, you know, we go from at the basic level thinking there's got to be more to life to actually trying to think about it, contemplate it, and deal with it. And you might take three steps backwards and two back, and you know, you might walk away from God then come back. It's not that battle. It's the battle zone. That's where the real struggle is. And this is also the level associated with prayer. So the lowest level of Nefesh is associated with actions, the second level with prayer, the third level with is the intellect, so that's Torah study. And the fourth level would be doing all of these things with a group, not just yourself. So again, once you get past the first three, you're dealing with that idea. So prayer itself, the word for prayer, tefillah, the root of that word has to do with connection. You find that's true with a lot of these terms, the korban, I think, let's see, the sacrifice, incense, even da'at, knowledge. There's one or two others. All of their root words, either in Hebrew or Aramaic, have something to do with connection, connecting us from here to God. So it's real interesting how many terms are around that. One of the ideas we've talked a lot about too is, you know, how these soul levels connect from above to below. Same with the Omer count, you know, from above to below, below to above. And this idea of us down here and, you know, the God and the deepest mysteries being above, and we through prayer, meditation, and Torah study, we ascend to learn more and make these deeper connections, and then we bring them back down to earth. And that also is also the idea here, that we stimulate response from above, from the spiritual realm. So when we do things right, good stuff happens, right? It's kind of a cycle. And when we don't do things right, then the opposite is true. So you have this idea of going and coming back, which is in Daniel 12:4, talks about in the end of days, he talks about, and I'm not saying we're in the end of days, who knows? He says many will travel to and fro, and knowledge, da'at, will increase. And this is understood by the sages in Israel that this is spiritually ascending, mostly through meditation with Torah study together, to get these deeper concepts that God will make available. Hashem makes everything available as it's needed. So in the end of days, as you can see these ideas that evil starts to manifest and get stronger, which is part of the plan. It's necessary. So what we need on the other side of that will be made available to us in terms of being able to access deeper Torah concepts, It says in the book of Joel, chapter 2, I think, that God will pour out his spirit and people will have dreams and prophecy. All this wild stuff is going on in a good sense at the same time that all the other wild stuff, the difficult things in the world and the calamities and all that is also occurring. So they go hand in hand. Excuse me. So another concept of connection that's important, it's one that comes into play a little bit tonight, is when you're talking about the first level or the Nefesh level or the emanation called Malkut Kingdom, you're talking about the idea of the, it's a spiritual persona called the bride, or also called the Shekhinah, okay? So it's a divine feminine aspect that is within and among this world and within everyone, particularly within the souls of those of Israel and those seeking God. So you have this idea of the bride, but because things aren't the way they are or will be or should be, the bride is separated from the groom. So the name of God is not one at this time. That's why Zechariah says in that day at the end, his name will be one. That is when the idea of the bride being reunited with the groom. So you see this throughout Torah literature. So the bride is associated with that first level of the soul and the lowest level of existence that we're in. And then that level where I mentioned earlier was the level of struggle of the connecting above to below. That's the level of the groom. And so this whole idea of connecting the bride and the groom is a main theme, not only on an individual level for each of us, but also collectively. And that's how and why we need to meet together to help make that happen. Because the better and faster we make that happen, we really are impacting, we're not only just impacting the status of the world, but we're impacting the calendar, so to speak, in terms of bringing Mashiach sooner rather than later. So the last emanation, we're doing the Omer count, as you know, during the Omer count, the 7 weeks. The first 6 weeks have to do with the aspect of the groom, those six emanations from Chesed down to Yesod. So that's from loving kindness down to foundation. Those six have to do with the masculine or bridegroom aspect. And then the seventh one, Malkut, is the Shekhinah, the divine presence, the lower feminine, which is the bride. And so you're connecting the six of those with the seventh, which becomes like a seven. And so when you think of a Jewish wedding, right, and the bride circles the groom seven times, she's the seven, she's going around the groom who is six, and that equals this other, I don't get too much into gematria, but hold on a second. Sorry about that. My doggy was looking for a chair to sit on, and now he has one. Where was I? Oh yeah, so this idea of the bride and the groom coming together, and when they're coming together, things are all joined together now, and everything is, sorry, I must have hit that ahead of time. Everything is lined up together, and the blessing of God comes down into our world. So anyway, that's the concept of the bride and the groom coming together. I wanted to read you a quote here. Hold on. Oh yeah. So here's an interesting quote. This is from a book called Yedid Nefesh, Song of the Soul, Rabbi Yechiel Bar Lev. And he says, I'll read this. It's a very short quote. The purpose of worshiping God is to bring about the coupling of the groom and the bride. He uses some technical terms here, but the purpose of worshiping God is to bring about the coupling of the groom and the bride. Because when that happens, everything comes together, and that's the restoration, the redemption, and all of that happens, okay? And the word here for worship, of course, worship in Hebrew is avodah, and it's not just like you go to a building one day of the week and start singing and throwing your hands up and all. Worship really means it means work. It's your day-to-day actions. You know, the works you do on a regular basis are what constitutes avodah, worship in Hebrew. So it does mean praising God and like that, but literally it does mean work. It's the same word used for work and for prayer as well. So again, connecting the first two levels, the one we were at last week and the Nefesh level of Chayah, and this week at Ruach level of Chayah. So we're making, every time we get to the second level, we're kind of connecting back to where we came from last week, the bride, and looking forward to where the now working this connection and making it all go forward. So tonight, as I mentioned, because it's the second week and we're focused on the Ruach level, which is the level of prayer. It's a level of a lot of different things, but prayer is a main theme for the Ruach level of each of these levels. So again, we're at Ruach of Chayah, just like we were at Ruach of the others in the previous 3 months. So this is a wonderful example, as I mentioned earlier, the concept of prayer, even the root word of the root of tefillah means to make connection. So this is a prayer written by Rabbi Arya Kaplan. If you're not familiar with him, he's an extraordinary teacher of the past century, passed away, unfortunately, when he was in his late 40s. And he is a translator and interpreter and commentator on multiple difficult texts, including Sefer Yetzirah, Sefer Habahir, Sefer Habahir, and others, written a lot of books. Anything by Arya Kaplan is gold. So you don't even have to ask, should I get this book? If you want to get an Arya Kaplan book and you can afford it, buy it, because it's just absolutely the best stuff. So he wrote this prayer, and this is real interesting. This is from his book, Meditation in the Bible. He did three books on meditation, Meditation in Kabbalah, Meditation in the Bible, and I think the other one was just called Jewish Meditation. I forget. I've got it somewhere here. But he wrote this prayer, and he wrote it around the 10 emanations of God called 10 Sephirot, which is real interesting. And we're not going to spend a lot of time on this one, but I just want to show you how the concept of connectivity here, because he starts at the highest emanation of Keter, which means crown, which is above the head. And he goes down through these 10 emanations. I put the name of the emanation, the Hebrew name, in the parentheses there. So it starts at Keter, which is crown, and then Chokhmah, wisdom. I'll look at the first two, and then Elohim Haim. That's an interesting one. So that's Elohim is a name of God that's associated with judgment, not necessarily a bad thing, but just judgment in general. And Haim, of course, like when you toast L'chaim, it's life. Similar to down near the bottom where you see El Chai, God of the living, right? Down at the bottom. But you have these first two emanations of Chokhmah and Bina, which are interesting because this is the father and mother concepts of God. And yes, there's obviously both, because in Genesis says we are made in the image of God, male and female, we are made. So this is the upper masculine, feminine dimensions. In Kabbalah, Chokhmah, wisdom is masculine on the right side, and Bina, understanding, is on the left side. The easiest way I like to use to describe the two, Chokhmah is very singular. Everything's kind of packaged in one, and Bina breaks it apart and starts breaking apart all the details and analyzing it. So I always say, well, it's like father and mother. So the story I tell, very short, is the father, Chokhmah, comes home and says, hey, I got great news, family. We're all going to go to Disney World. And the kids start screaming all happy on the couch, jump in, and it's all this commotion. We're going to Disney. That's Chokhmah. And then Bina, the mother, comes in and says, hold on a second. We have to plan budgets. We have to plan, babysitters. We have to plan time off from work. We have to, mom starts breaking it down so that, get the proper understanding. So that's the balance between Chokhmah and Bina. Chokhmah is from the right side and says, got this great idea. Bina says, all right, let's take a look at that and break it down. And then we go from there down into the lower seven, which are the seven that we deal with during the Omer count right now. So we'll touch on this a little bit, maybe come back to it a little bit tonight, because we're going to look at three different prayers in Judaism, three interesting ones, particularly with that aspect of connection. And we're going to get into some things you probably won't find in other places. So if it's something that is like kind of a original idea or something, I'll state that. Anything else, generally when I'm talking about it, I don't make stuff up. It's grounded in Torah or oral Torah, Hasidic views. But if it's something that I think is, interesting or creative that I may have thought of or come up with, I'll say that this is my own idea. and you can take it or leave it, you know. Please. So real quick, if you see that second line of Chokmah, Yah, Y-A-H, that's when you take the Yud, the first letter of Yod-Hei, and then Vav-Hei, the first letter of the four-letter name, and the second letter, Hei. Just those two together form the word Yah. It's one of the names of God. These are all names of God, by the way, down the left. So Eyeh Asher Eyeh is I am that I am in Genesis, which is the greater truth, because if you take Eyeh and Eyeh, the numerical value of each is 21. You multiply 21 times 21. That's called a chibur of a number when they're multiplied. And you don't make up ideas this way. The idea already exists. Gematria is just used to reinforce things. 21 times 21 is 441, which is the gematria of emet, which is truth. So this is the highest truth, is that there is God that we understand, but this is God beyond our understanding, outside of existence. And we're going to come back to that in a minute. Yah is the first level of God that we do deal with, which is the Yud and the Hey and the masculine aspect. And then Elohim Haim, which is one of the ways referred to for Bina. Elohim being the aspect of restriction or judgment. In fact, that's the first name of God that you see in the Torah in Genesis, right? Because before that, there was nothing but God. And then God had to restrict of himself and to make room or something else. So it's a type of judgment, restriction, all those things on the left are often associated with Elohim. So anyway, we might come back to this prayer later, but it's just the idea here is he's going down through these names of God from the highest all the way down to Adonai, which is used for the idea of God, the presence of God in this world. So Adonai is another word for used sometimes for Shekhinah, on the bride, but it's also used to talk about God in a sense, in a general sense of here. So like when you do the Shema, most people do the Shema and say Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, but the text itself, of course, says is the four-letter name Yod-Heh Vav-Heh. So you might hear some Orthodox actually say Hashem Eloheinu, Hashem Echad, or something like that, because they don't use the four-letter name. So anyhow, this is just the prayer. We'll come back to this if anyone wants to later, because it's really fascinating that he wrote this prayer. But we are going to look at three actual prayers that are used on a semi-regular basis to different levels within the Jewish world. One you might know for sure, and one you might have heard of, and the other one you might not at all, but who knows? So let's take a look here. Okay, so if you're not familiar, and you should be seeing that chart, right, on the right. Just wanna make sure I gotta move a couple things out of the way here, because I got screens covering screens here. All right, so you see our famous chart here on the right here, Mode Ani, is that what you got on your screens? Just give me a yes or a...
Yeah, I see it.
Cool. All right. So Mode Ani, well, let me just first start. If you're not familiar with the chart on the right, we show this every week. This chart is the basis for all Torah learning. Wow, right? And I did not invent the chart. I'd simply colorized it. I'd simply put it on screen. On the left, you go from top to bottom. You have this idea of a pre-existent, transcendent God we know nothing about. And then you have the idea of God within existence. And then the beginning of creation in Genesis, the angelic world. If you think of Jacob's ladder and the dream that he had, right? You have he dreams of these angels going back and forth between the physical world and heaven above. So that's how things came down in terms of the whole aspect of there being nothing but God. And then first, there was a level of existence that was the first separate consciousness, if you will, than just only God. And it's like a poor copy of that, in that it's very singular, like I mentioned earlier, that aspect of Chokhmah, wisdom. It's very singular, but it's not pure singularity. We can still identify things at this level. And then within creation, when you get down to that middle level there in the blue, the beginning of creation, that's where the creation account says, in the beginning, God created. That word bara for creation is this same word as beria, which means creation. So that's where that starts. And so he creates the heavenly realms, the heavenly temple and the ark forces and powers that some traditions call the archangels. And then below that, in like in Jacob's dream, you have the ladder with the angels going up and down, and then our world below that. And conversely, going back up, that's the path of the levels of the soul that we're talking about in this project. The nefesh level is, everyone's at the nefesh level, you wouldn't be here. It's very self-centered in a way that can be good or bad. It's self-preservation, which is a good thing, but it can easily be all about you, which is a bad thing. And then but within that is the spark. The spark from above and beyond is within every person that connects you to God. And when you wake up to that one day and you start to struggle and say, you know, there's got to be more to this life than just, you know, eating, drinking, and sleeping, and, you know, being sick and sad. So when when that starts to register, that's the level of Ruach you deal with. And when you spend enough time in there fighting the good fight, and you make a true connection, a true spiritual connection to God above, that's the neshama level. And generally speaking, those are all the three levels of the soul that I said earlier are considered, quote, within the body or within us. And that's generally, if you get to this level, fully get to this level and make that kind of connection with God, then you've done well with your life. We can touch upon the Chayah level, and really, it is a level that in some sense we have to deal with and understand. And this is the level where we're all connected. It's no longer just about you. It's no longer just about personal consciousness. Now it's collective consciousness. And so the person, the individual's path, you, me, and everyone else, the individual's path to God up to this point of Chayah is you and God. But now if you want to keep going, you're going to go through this level, which is the level of you and other people, which goes back to everything to am I my brother's keeper, right? Back in the very beginning of Genesis and the Cain and Abel story, and to all of these quotes we see in the Bible about God wanting unity amongst the brethren and assembling together. All of these quotes are all related to this idea that we are all connected at this level, and we have to get to and through this level ourselves to really, really connect at a higher level of God, but also to cause things to change in this world and especially bring on the redemption and all of that. So Mode Ani, back to the prayer. Mode Ani, it's very dry in here, so that's why I'm sipping so much. It's not vodka, I swear. Mode Ani is a prayer that is the prayer that is said first thing in the morning by a lot of people, religious Jews, of course, and other people too. And there's a reason that it's said first thing in the morning, because this prayer, and that's it on the left, Mode Ani Lefanechem Elokai V'Kayam Shehazata B'Mishpatim Bechama Rabba Emunatecha. Amen. And this prayer is different than all others. It's different than the Shema. It's different than every other prayer, because all other prayers, we are directly acknowledging one of the names of God, an aspect of God. We're talking like directly like to God that we can comprehend in some way. The Mode Ani recognizes that there's an aspect of God or level of God that is transcendent, that is something that we cannot begin to grasp. We just know this much. We know that whatever we end up learning about God, whatever we think about God now or tomorrow, is, to quote Daniel Matt, is puny. It's puny compared to what the real essence of God is. So we acknowledge that there is more to the Creator than anything we can comprehend or talk about or talk to. And so the only way we can do this, this prayer does not use any of the names for God. We simply, and this is the level of Yechida, which is that unified level of the soul with God that goes before existence. It's the concept of, like I said, the transcendent God, or before Genesis 1:1, before anything that we can even, if you can think about it, it's not at this level. This is something else totally. And so the only thing that we use, because this is also that level of Keter, we talked about crown a minute ago, if you remember on the previous page, crown being not part of the body, but above and beyond the body. The crown is the one, Keter is the one Sephira that's not aligned with a body part because it's beyond. Because of that, I lost my train of thought. Well, it's associated with that aspect of God that is outside of existence. So we refer to God as king, as eternal king, because there's really nothing we can try to even associate with it, because it's outside of the boundaries of definitions or anything we can think of. So this is why the Moda Ani is the first prayer, even before a religious Jew would wash your hands or anything like that. It's acknowledging that, hey, no matter what my issues or problems or concerns or anything are, you pre-existed all. And I'm just recognizing that, you know, beyond my problems, even beyond the ways I'm going to try to fix my problems with you, God, you exist beyond any of that. So it's very deep in that respect, very mystical, yet it's also very simple, that there's something beyond it all. So that's the idea of the Moda Ani, that you start your day off with that. And sleep is called, it's one of these things that you hear in the Kabbalistic text, that where something is 1/60th, and there's reasons why that's the fraction, but something is 1/60th of something. So Shabbat's 1/60th of the Messianic age or the world to come. Dreams are 1/60th of prophecy. You hear, this is the term that's used. So sleep is 1/60th of death. And all that means is because we're disconnected from the world when we sleep. So it's likened to, in some, not a bad way, but likened to death in that respect. So it's called 1/60th of death. So when we arise in the morning, in one sense, it's almost like we're resurrecting. It's a whole new day, right? Starting out. I think, I don't know if that's something Luke might be addressing later tonight, but when we do the meditation part. But it's an interesting concept. So you can see that the whole idea of Moda Ani starting the day is we're addressing what's called the source of sources beyond anything. So that's the Moda Ani prayer. And it's recognizing, as I said, it's focused on that highest level. We're looking at our chart of the Yahida level of the soul and God outside of existence. All right, hold that thought. Now we're gonna go to a prayer that you're much more familiar with, probably. If not, that's okay. And that's called the Shema. There's a lot of stuff on the screen here, so hold on, we'll get to it in a second. But here's the interesting thing about the Shema. And no, this isn't anything I invented. It's something I was pondering and actually found it in the Zohar, which is interesting because the Zohar talks about this idea that there is an aspect of God that we cannot comprehend, right, outside of existence. And yet there's an aspect of God that we do comprehend to some degree because we read about God in the Bible. We talk about God like we're doing right now. We'll pray to God. All of that is at the lower, I hate to use the word lower, it's at the immanent aspect of God. So you have a transcendent aspect and an immanent aspect. And the Zohar says that despite the fact that these two things are as opposite can be, there's only one God. It's just one God, period, end of sentence. So, and the Zohar goes on to say, and that's why we're here, to figure out what that means. That this is what the Zohar loves to play games with your mind like this. It's like, now think about that, right? It's like, oh, great, thank you. So you have the Shema, which is interesting because the Shema is a simple prayer in the morning, Deuteronomy 6:4, Shema Yisrael. And again, it's Hashem or Yod-Heh Vav-Heh in the text. Often people do use the word Adonai. They're both good. They're both acceptable. So I'm using Hashem now for the purpose of this instruction. So Hashem, Eloheinu, which is a variant of Elohim, and then Hashem Echad. So you have four lines there. And basically what the Zohar is telling us is that, first of all, and this is found in a Midrashic text as well, that when you hear Shema, it's not just hear. It's like hear attentively, hear with... I forget the psychological term there, that type of active listening or something, but pay attention to something really important here. This is critical. That's what Shema means. Like, wake up, listen, here we go, okay? And this is something very simple. It says that Hashem and then Eloheinu and then Hashem Echad. And the way the Zohar says is like, there is Hashem, which it understands. In this text with the Zohar, the term Hashem here is understood and related to the concept of God outside of existence, okay? That's the transcendent God, and that's what it's saying, yep, Hashem. And then Eloheinu or Elohim, it's saying, and here is this concept of God that you deal with on a regular day-to-day basis. And also, it's also the concept of the nations when they had false gods, all kinds of gods. they're called Elohim. Pharaoh in Exodus, I forget the chapter 4 or 5, it's toward the beginning, says that, like he recognizes all the gods, but he says, but I don't know this Hashem. You know, I don't know this idea that you're presenting me, that this is like the source of sources or the God of gods beyond gods, you know? So the Zohar here is saying that what the Shema is saying is that, yes, there's this Hashem aspect of God outside of existence, Elohim or Eloheinu, within existence. And then it says, Hashem Echad, meaning that all of that is encompassed or included within the eternal, within Hashem. So Hashem Echad is saying that those two aren't two different things. Like they're really one. They're one and the same. And that may sound kind of complex or simple, depending on your perspective, but it's important because it's making that connection. Whereas the Modeani prayer says there's this God outside of existence, and I recognize you, eternal King. I don't even know what to think of you, but I know you're there. And now the Shema says, okay, let's connect that, because that's, you know, outside of everything. Let's bring it closer to our reality. So it the Zohar says, well, yes, that's true. And it's the same God you deal with on a day-to-day basis. So although you aren't addressing that unknowable God, because you can't, you're addressing the same God, even though it seems like it's a different thing. It's not. So that's the deeper aspect of what the Zohar, and if you're looking for where in the Zohar, it's in 2 is Exodus. We see Zohar 1 is Genesis, Zohar 2 is Exodus, 3 is Leviticus, and there's other things besides the books of the Torah. But anyway, it's in that 161 A and B, if you're looking for the reference. So now what else is interesting here too is that the aspect of Chokhmah, wisdom, as we mentioned earlier, is associated with the masculine. So when you think of Abba, our Father in heaven, right? God the Father, our Father in heaven, God, that's associated with Chokhmah. So where does that leave the feminine, Bina? Well, Bina, I always like to use the Russian doll analogy, where you have one doll over the other, right? So Bina is included within Chokhmah. Everything starts at the top. So it goes from Keter to Chokhmah to Bina. So everything that comes after is enclosed or encompassed, I forget the word, within what came before. So when we say Chokhmah or Abba, I should say, when we say Father, that includes the divine feminine aspect of God that we're created in the image of God, Genesis chapter 1. So that's where you get that God name Yah, Y-A-H, or Yud, and the Yud and the Hey includes the, when you say Father, you mean Mother. When you say Hey, it includes when you say Yud, it includes the Hey. Okay, they're together. So what's interesting here is you find a lot of interesting things in Kabbalistic writings. If you think of the Ten Commandments, and usually the way they're depicted, you know, when you see a picture of the tablets, which is not even accurate, by the way, but you always see like 4 commandments on the left and 6 commandments on the right, because the first 4 are associated with God and the other 6 are associated with your fellow humans. Well, the Kabbalists say, well, not so fast. The 5th commandment, honor thy father and mother, is connected to this, Abba and Ima, your divine father, mother, that you're made in the image of. So Kabbalists actually kind of sway that commandment over to the left side, if you will, or the first side, saying that it has to do, it also does have to do with your regular mom and dad, of course, but they're saying there's a deeper aspect to this, and that's to recognize this image of God that you're created in, because all of these teachings and ideas flow from that or stem from that. So that's pretty interesting. And the mother feminine aspect, Bina, is interesting because it not only connects back to Chokhmah and Keter, that direction, but it's kind of like the pivot, or not the word I'm looking for, linchpin, what's the word I'm looking for? The connecting point between the mind of God, or the higher levels, and the 7 below, which are the 7 below are the ones we deal with on a day-to-day basis, and the 7 weeks of the Omer count, and the 7 Ushbizi and guest at Sukkot. So that when you see number 7, it's associated with the world we live in primarily, and you know, the surrounding elements of the angels and all of that. And when you see the full number of 10, which includes the 3 above, it's generally speaking a much broader spiritual scheme, if you will, including these higher elements. So not getting too much into the numerology number thing, but it's just good information. So let's see. Just looking here to see if there was something else I wanted to mention. All right, so this is the Shema now. So we went from the Mode Ani, starting the day, that talks about God before any existence, that we know you're out there. We don't even know what you are. Shema is saying, well, that God that's out there that we don't relate to is the same God we do relate to. So we've made that connection. And we know that Bina, the mother and father, never separated. That's another concept in Kabbalah, those two aspects. There's never any division between Chokhmah and Bina, between the father-mother aspect of God. It's always unified, okay? So now we've got the first three united, and we know that Bina, the way it, I think I had a quote on Bina. Hold on, give me a second here. Here it is. This is, I might as well read this. Oh, by the way, that diagram to the right, if you see some strange things on it, it's actually taken from my Matrix study, which is the Torah study that I do through the Matrix movies, believe it or not, if you're not familiar with that. So you might see some little references on there that are aligned with the movie script. So here's a text on Bina, that emanation that connects to the higher realms before it and then down to us. This is from a book called Sha'arei Ora, Gates of Light, Yosef Gikatia, 12th century, folks. So this is a few years old. He says, the Sephirah called Bina, you must be aware that this is the name that connects all the Sephirot with its powerful bonds of emanation and magnetism, for this is the third name of the three highest names, as you can see right there, right? That are united and intimate with Keter, the highest, which is beyond existence, right? And he says, from the name Bina, the ever flow of light, emanation, and blessing flows down through the channels until the lower seven Sephirot are blessed from the upper three. So Bina, the mother aspect, like a mother with her children below. And oh, by the way, if you look at Proverbs chapter 9, the very beginning, it says Chokhmah has built her temple. Normally, that's saying Chokhmah's temple, but the her here, Kabbalistically, is Bina, right? Chokhmah, which is the masculine in Kabbalah, has built her temple, Bina, which rests on what? Seven pillars, look below, the seven emanations below. So Proverbs is hinting at this scheme as well. Chapter 9, I believe it is, right at the beginning. So now we've got this connection made from Keter, with the Mode Ani, all the way through Bina with the Shema, because it includes the masculine and feminine. And now we come to a prayer that is less well known by far, yet it's one that's said at different times. Hold on. Ana Bakoach. Okay. And I'm not going to get into this in great detail. This is considered the most mystical prayer in Judaism. All right. And it's a prayer of, in the Hebrew, well, it's seven lines and six words per line in the Hebrew, not in the English, of course, but six words per line. So there's your concept of uniting the seven and the six, the bride and the bridegroom, of bringing that together. So it's associated with 40, the number 42, or what's actually called the 42 letter name of God, which is not a name made up of 42 letters per se, but it's a concept of speaking of God when everything, the bride and groom and everything is together. So anytime you see a spiritual window opening, you'll often see the number 42 applied. So in the Torah, when they went from Egypt to Israel, they had 42 steps along the way, 42 steps of their journey, which each one, they were all, if you recall, they were there for all different times, maybe a few days or weeks, maybe a few months or years. It was very odd. And they didn't really know why exactly they'd have to pick up and move to the next place. But every one of those, it's taught, had something specific about it that they were there to deal with or rectify. So, and the rabbis say that, the sages say, we all go through our own 42 steps in life. It's just kind of a figure of speech, but it's saying that we all have these things that we have to rectify. So when you do the Omer count, the first 6 weeks, you're dealing with those six aspects of the masculine aspects, which is that of struggle that we're talking about tonight at the Ruach level. And then the seventh and final week, you're at the feminine the Malkut level, where you're taking all those things you've been dealing with, and now you're bringing them down to earth, literally, and working on them like on a more consistent basis. You see this reflected, we talked about it a few weeks back, in Stephen Covey's writings. He's an author, passed away a few years ago, but he wrote a book called The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, which is, if you read that, it sounds like a rabbinic text. It's amazing. It aligns perfectly with the Omer count. It's really weird. But he does the same thing. The first 6 weeks, the first six aspects are things that we learn to deal with. And the seventh one is where you practice it. Or he called it sharpening the saw. You practice it on a daily basis. So the same concept exists there. So anyway, Anaba Koach is based around these seven lower emanations. So it's obviously directly related to the Omer count. A few weeks ago, I've been posting every day on the Omer count on my wall. If you go back several weeks, go back to, hold on, it's the Anaba Koach would have been the third week. Yeah, the third week, which was Tiferet, right? Yeah. Which is the bridegroom. So if you scroll way back on my wall to the third week of the Omer count, each of those 7 days, I posted something from the Anaba Koach prayer. And also how the number 42 comes in each of those days. So you'll have to go back and find that and scroll that. But anyhow, so the Anaba Koach now is a prayer. As we saw with the first prayer, Mode Ani was talking about God outside existence, and the Shema connected God outside of existence with God within existence. And then, by the way, after the Shema in verse 5 of chapter 6 of Deuteronomy starts the Ve'ahavta prayer, which says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and strength, and mind. It says soul, but it's considered the mind. So you have the physical, emotional, and intellectual there together. And by the way, you see love the Lord your God. You see the concept there of Hashem Elohim right there again. So every time now, when you read your Bibles and you see the dual name Lord your God, or that phrase Hashem Elohim, now it should trigger you to think that this is talking, it's combining the idea of God outside of existence and God within existence. So it's called a dual name. You know where you see that is in Genesis chapters 2 and 3, I think. It's the Garden of Eden story. At the beginning, when God's creating stuff, it's Elohim. And then when you shift to the Garden of Eden, all of a sudden it's Yod Heh Vav Heh dash Elohim all through that. And then when they get kicked out, it goes to just plain four-letter name of God appears just by itself. You have this strange transition. But again, these names of God all relate to these concepts like that. So this is the Anaba Koach, which is a prayer of unifying the lower seven, just like the Omer count. And it goes through them one at a time. And like I said, it's way too complex to get into. Maybe some other night where we can look at this. But that's what this prayer is about. So you go one, and again, there's six words in each line. So it's a concept here of unifying the bride and the groom. So when you make this connection with the lower seven, you now connect yourself to Bina above, the mother aspect, which connects to Chochmah, the father aspect, which connects back beyond time too. So you have this whole idea of connectivity present through prayer, but it's very specifically broken down Kabbalistically when you look at these prayers like this. And again, this is the Anaba Koach is actually found in the Sidurim and various in prayer books, most of them, all of them. And it said, some traditions have it said on Shabbat, the end of the Omer count. So we might look at this on the 24th, whatever that date is. We're going to have a Wednesday night Zoom room at the end of the last night. More on that. So there's different times, even with the Shema at nighttime, people, some traditions bring this prayer in with it. And again, it's the whole idea here is you're saying this prayer and you're making this connection from the lower feminine through the masculine to the upper feminine. And that's the idea of, by the way, that's the idea of Jacob between Rachel and Leah. Rachel is at Malkut, Leah is at Bina, and Jacob is the six Sephirot that are in the middle struggling to make all that work out. That's what all that represents. Okay, so that's a lot of talking. What I wanted to do, Luke's got just one meditation tonight, so I wanted to play Anabakoic. I wanted to play two versions of the Anabakoic song. What I'll do is I'll play one right now, and while it's playing, I'll look and see if I'm some questions that came through, and then we'll take a little break of a couple of minutes after I play this, okay? And then when we come back, I'll play the other version of it and see if there's any questions, and then Luke can take over with his meditation part of the night. So hold on a second while I, well, first, is there any particular, let me see, just to see if there was, I had the screen covered, so I apologize if I missed any questions. There may have been, I'm just looking real quick. Trying to get this to work. I have a cat meowing behind me and he wants to get fed. I'm trying to get this to scroll bar. Yeah, the recordings for these are, yeah, they're up on the Matrix site. We'll post the link later or someone can post it. I'm just looking to say real quick here. Okay, so we'll come back to see. So let me put a recording on. So, okay, here's how it's going to work. Two recordings, one done by men and one done by women. No, we're not going to vote. It's not a game show, but I'm going to play them both, okay? So it's the same song, Anabakoa, and it's just the lyrics, and they're both very nice versions, okay? They're very different. So I'm going to play the first one. The video is not quite as clear. It's a little older video, but the audio should be okay. So hold on while I play this. Okay, I'm going to mute myself. Hold on a second, I'm having some technical issues here, so give me a second. Hold on a second. I don't know what happened to the audio on this. I got to find a better recording of it. I tell you, let's take a break now, okay? Let's just take a break, get a drink, whatever you got to do. I'm going to work on finding a better quality recording of this because it wasn't coming through for beans. So go ahead and take a 2-minute break and we'll queue it up when you come back. So feel free to hit the refrigerator or whatever else you got to do real quick. I have no idea what's going on. I've just looked at four versions of the same recording, and I don't know if it's my computer or what, but there's something wrong. All four of them are doing the same weird thing. It starts off okay for like 2 seconds, and then the music just drops off, and all you hear is some percussion. So I don't know what's going on or if it's my computer. So what I'll do is I'll play... I'll play just the other version with the ladies, and have to figure out what's wrong at some other point. So let me cue up that one because it's a lovely recording too. So we're going to hear two women singing, and they have a little band, and the band's all women too. And a really beautiful version as well. So this is Anabakoak as sung by a couple women in Israel. So let me cue this up. Hopefully this will work better. Second. There's a cat behind me. I'm gonna get this yet. Share screen. Where are we? Here it is. Okay, here we go.
Thank you.
I'm just going to stop the share there because it's just, I don't know what's going on with my, or if it's YouTube. Give me a second here to. Yeah, that's never happened before. That's weird. Okay, so sorry about that, but it happens. I'll get you the link later, ABC or PM me. I'll just get you the link. It's the Anna Vakolpra, but I don't remember the artist's two women's names. One thing that is interesting, though, is the woman on the right is very, from a very religious community, and the one on the left is a pop singer. And they got together, which is kind of neat, you know, the whole spectrum there, right, of you know, singing that together, which is nice. Yeah, there's different traditions around all the prayers, many different traditions. And some of those traditions change with certain circumstances, particularly where we are, not just those traditions, but other ones too, like where we are in history in terms of, I don't want to say anything too weird, but, you know, just in terms of where we are in history, that there are things that are important to get out, disseminate into the public sphere ASAP regarding certain things that without getting too much into it. So anyhow, that is a chopped up. I'll have to get you all the links so you can hear it, and the other one too, because it's beautiful, beautifully done prayer when you sing it. It's really pretty. Luke, how are you doing? Are you are that with us?
Yeah, doing good. I love that version of the song.
Yeah, it's pretty it's pretty nice. Very nice. I just wish it had played better, but I'll correct that and get a link. I'll get the link out to everybody that wants to hear it. So this clearly this video is going to take a little editing before I put it online, because that was kind of a mess there. All right. So if you're all set, I'm gonna just like hand it over to you then, and to continue on this evening's festivities.
Sure.
You still having trouble with your video?
Yeah, but I think audio is working okay. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, the audio is great.
Okay, good. Audio it is. All right. So hello, everybody. Welcome back. The holy light from... Oh, man. All right, so I hope everyone's doing all right tonight. So last week we covered a basic awareness of this interconnectedness and how our desires and the aim behind the desire altogether would be the intention is either directed towards ourself, whether it's a self-seeking desire, whether I want to receive this, whatever it is, for myself, or if it's something altruistic where I can receive it in order to give it. I don't really want to hang on to whatever it is I'm receiving, because essentially I have this sensation and I know that everyone, I'm connected to everyone, and literally everything that I desire, intend, think, speak, or any actions that I do affect the whole, whether I realize it or not. So so as we're dealing with Chayah, and this is the world of Atzilut, so upon entering the world of Atzilut, we can actually correct our past desires, and this is appropriate since we are going through the Midot of the Omer count. And these desires are connected to our Midot. This one good example that was told to me a long time ago was, have you ever had a lot of difficulty being present because you're wanting something other than what's before you? So this is why we have this emotional struggle connected to our desires, because Hashem places what we need in front of us, but we want this other thing that that's either somewhere else, or it's another day, or it's another moment, you know. But we have to learn to be fully present with Hashem, because he's always present. We're just not present. So that's what we're striving to do. We're striving to become present. And as soon as we really access this presence, we learn that we're not cut off from the other souls, right? We start to get a sensation that we're all interconnected. So upon entering the world of Absolute, where we feel the sensation of this interconnectedness, we can correct our past desires and thereby reach higher spiritual elevation and consciousness. And this process is actually known as the resurrection of the dead in Kabbalistic terminology. So the past few months, we've been going through the gradual correction of the souls through Nefesh, Yetzirah, and Neshama. And then through this, we reach what's called the realization of evil in oneself, or what it is that's preventing us from making this connection, right? We realize that all of our desires are actually egoistic, and they're all kind of directed towards receiving for myself, and most of the time at the expense of others. So what we have to learn, first of all, is we have to get to an awareness of this and then make a restriction over our desires. Another term for this restriction is called Tzimtzum. We become aware of how most of our desires are directed to receive for ourselves. And then once we actually attain this intention, just to completely restrict all the things that we want to receive for ourselves, then we move consciously with the help of a new awareness that Hashem gives us. And we acquire the intention not to receive for oneself. And in doing so, our desire to receive for oneself dies, quote unquote. So those old desires that we really wanted, and as we progress in each spiritual level, our desires increase, they grow, they expand, right? And so does our I, our ego, our sense of self. It all expands, and everything has to be subdued all over again each time we climb the ladder. So through studying Kabbalah daily and trying to feel the state that is being described and yearning to attain its qualities, we attract the surrounding light, also known as the Or Makif, which comes and corrects and raises our state and intention to a higher level. And this higher level would be to receive for the sake of the Creator, to receive Lishma. Now, then Torah study is the same thing. So we're studying Torah, we're doing mitzvot, we're praying. That's why the prayer service itself, the divine prayer service, is not about me. It's about we, right? So I'm coming to correct something in myself in order to elevate others, because essentially we're all connected. And then the Maggid of Mezrik, the way he describes praying for everyone is you sense and feel yourself as part of the divine presence, because you are. We're not separate souls all over the world. We're one soul. But there's only this illusion of separateness and this condensed feeling and weight of being constricted in a body. And so through the study of Kabbalah and meditation and prayer and mitzvot, this condensed feeling and sensation of being trapped in a physical form kind of reverses. And we start to expand beyond this. We start to sense the connection beyond this. Now that we have basically acquired this new intention and state, once we reach the level of Lishma, we attach our desires, which we previously made the restriction over, and we resurrect them by clothing them in the intention to receive for Hashem's sake. So all those old desires that we put aside before because we couldn't receive anything with them for the sake of Hashem, for the sake of elevating others, now we're bringing them back because we have this, we're entering into this new state where we can receive as a vessel, right? We're receiving the light, not just for ourselves, but so that it can pass through us outward towards others. And this, you know, thereby feeling this interconnectedness and allowing all this pleasure to pass through you towards others. And another word for light is pleasure. So we're clothing these old desires in the correct intention. And in so doing, we're reconnecting them, of course, and we're resurrecting them for the sake and benefit of others above ourselves. So thus we're correcting our egoistic desires connected to the midot and using them in a completely new way. Okay. All right, so we just got one meditation for tonight, but I want to focus on one anyways because this one is pretty important. When it comes to our desires, we don't want to be all over the place. So essentially what we're talking about tonight is tefillah. Tefillah, so we use the term meditation a lot in the group, but when we go back through the text, the Kabbalistic and Hasidic text, there's no real word for meditation. There's hit bo dedut, hit bo nenut, there's tefillah, there's all these different words. That's essentially all mechanisms of tefillah, right? So if we learn to access through meditation that same mechanism, then it transforms our ability to pray. We have this whole different understanding and grasp of prayer and a whole new connection to Hashem that can be felt to greater and greater degrees and to others, connection to others. So essentially what we're doing is prayer, but not in the prayer in the way that we would normally think, you know, in a Western mindset. So go ahead and get into a comfortable position. Just kind of get everything out of your hands. You can place, maybe if you're laying down, you can place your hands next to you or on your chest, whatever is most comfortable. And just try to remain, keep your back straight, not because of some mystical reason, but because it helps keep your attention centered, because you don't want to be shifting around the whole time, because this will take your attention off what's being done in the meditation. All right, we're going to start with a little bit of what's called box breathing. It's 4x4 breathing, where we inhale, hold, exhale, and rest, all for a count of four each. So go ahead and close your eyes and we'll begin. Inhale, two, three, four, hold, two, three, four, exhale, two, three, four, rest, two, three, four. Inhale, two, three, four, hold, two, three, four, exhale, two, three, four, rest, two, three, four, inhale, two, three, four, hold, two, three, four, a rest, two, three, four. All right. Take a deep breath in. Take a deep breath all the way in. And then just kind of expel all that air. Use your stomach muscles. And just kind of relax your face and your neck, your shoulders, each arm, your back and your abdomen. Just as you're breathing, just kind of allow everything to just relax. Just scan from the top of your head down to your toes and just slowly allow everything to relax as you breathe out. So you're breathing in, you're bringing awareness to whatever tension is there. And as you're exhaling, you're allowing all that to just kind of melt and settle. Just kind of feel the connection between maybe you're laying on a bed, maybe the connection between you and the bed, or you and the chair, the body and whatever you're laying or sitting on. Maybe you can feel the ground under your feet. And just notice that these subtle shifts in attention takes your attention away from being kind of locked in this stream of thought. The more you kind of shift away from thinking into the sensation itself. When we experience the sensation, we're not really feeling physicality. Everything is felt from within. Just kind of bring your awareness into the breathing, the harmonious functioning of the body, how it's all just kind of happening. There's nothing that we really need to do. All we need to do is just witness it happen. And you can use this intention where, as you inhale, you're actually inhaling the exhalation of Hashem. Hashem's breathing into us. And then as we exhale, he's inhaling. And this can be very helpful. It takes attention away from the thoughts about the body and about whatever's going on in your life. You can just fully just kind of sink into that connection. A good analogy here would be whenever you're fully immersed into a story or a movie, you forget yourself entirely. But in that forgetting, you experience joy. You experience vibrance and aliveness. Within this breath that Hashem is always breathing into us, the breath itself isn't spiritual. What's spiritual is the life force and the desire to bestow life and pleasure and goodness that's within the breath. And everything that we think, that we desire, that we feel emotionally, this is all carried in the breath outward towards others as well into the atmosphere, what we'll call the atmosphere right now. Not necessarily the physical atmosphere, but we are all interconnected as one soul. So what one soul thinks, feels, and desires, it flows outwards towards everyone. So whether we realize it or not, every time we have a bad thought, consciously, not necessarily unconsciously, but when we consciously think of something over and over again on a thought loop, thinking about something I could have done to this person, or, you know, all these things, it's putting it out into the collective. So when we learn to abide in a certain state with a certain intention, we can shift that whole dynamic. Because it's in this whole inversion of our intention to receive that we start to feel a connection beyond ourselves. We have to stop thinking about ourselves so much and start thinking of others. And when the shift occurs, we start to feel what's beyond ourselves. So all of our desires, every thought we think, every word we speak, and every action that we make affects the whole through this non-locality, through this connection where all seemingly separate souls are actually one. The breath, all sense perceptions, the life force and the desire behind the breath, everything that we feel emotionally, all thoughts, desires, everything actually emanates from one source. Any negative thought or feeling that comes to you, or any negative situation, seemingly negative, is all coming to us for the sake of elevation. The Baal Shem Tov taught that every extraneous thought that comes to you in prayer comes to you in order to be elevated back to its source. And this is true of everything, because the way we pray is the way we live, and the way we live is the way we pray. So listen deeply and connect to the silence from which all thought emanates. What is that desire back there that what is that? What kind of intention is behind these thoughts? Do I desire things because I want them for myself? I want to experience pleasure. Sure, we all do. But is it just for me? When we begin to feel that connection beyond ourselves, we realize that everything that we're receiving is for all of us. So in this state, we have no choice but to receive in order to give, to receive for the sake of everyone, because we are everyone. So as we listen to the silence from which all thought emanates, we're connecting to the original thought of creation, the thought Hashem had in mind before the creation of the world. And the more we sink into this connection and awareness, we're aligning our intention with Hashem's desire to bestow goodness upon his creatures and all of creation. In this place, we are all united. Rising above our egoic desires, we can examine everything that is present within our consciousness. There's nothing that is hidden when we elevate to this level. We see all of our desires, our thoughts, which emanate from them, as if from a bird's eye view. We can see each desire that is only concerned with self-benefit, and how this is actually separating us from attaining a connection, from attaining a correction of our soul, and feeling this connection with Hashem through others. So now, without thinking about it, join into that collective intention, the thought of creation, which is to correct our egoistic desire so that we can elevate each other in the group and beyond the group to an attainment of higher consciousness and bring this down into the world, to bestow pleasure on all of creation, to become vessels of bestowal to others, and to always abide in this awareness of our interconnectedness. Hashem, help us see through the veil of physicality and the illusion of separation which keeps us from feeling each other as one and thinking of one another above our own self-benefit. Just open your heart to this connection. It's always here. There's never a time when it wasn't there. The more we access this faith above intellectual understanding, the deeper we feel the connection. As we move back down into the world, we want to bring back this impression of our interconnectedness and our awareness of the root issue of everything, which is our desire to receive for ourselves. We want to maintain this awareness always, because it's only through this awareness that this desire to receive for ourselves can be redirected and clothed in the proper intention. So we're coming back with an understanding that we should study and examine our desires daily, our desires and thoughts and emotions every single day, so that we can make proper restrictions and then consciously redirect those desires, those thoughts, towards connection. And in so doing, we're inverting the intention to receive for ourselves into receiving in order to give, making sure that we can use our desires in a way that will benefit others and be pleasing to Hashem. This is how we delight Hashem, by loving others. Loving others above ourselves, above our own desire to receive pleasure. Hashem, whose desire is for us to come together to love one another, to feel the connection between each other, and attain the state of unity where Hashem is revealed in our midst. Just come back to the sensation of Hashem breathing into you. this unconditional love being breathed into you, this desire for all of us to come together and love each other. It's more important than anything that we desire for ourselves. And as you exhale, just let your breath be your guide. You're inhaling this desire to bestow pleasure upon creation, and you're also exhaling it. You're redirecting that intention. You're receiving it and then redirecting it. This is called direct and reflected light. When you're ready, just open your eyes, but just try to remain in this state with your eyes open, where you're feeling and you're sensing beyond the physical. You're feeling and sensing beyond this illusion that we're all completely separate. Just because whenever you look around you, you see matter. You see division. But this is actually an illusion, because what we think we're seeing outside of ourselves is actually being perceived only on the inside. When we learn to expand this vessel, expand our consciousness, we learn to feel ourselves, even as inanimate objects, even as plants, even as animals, even as other human beings. And above that, and that connection feels more real than the physical reality that we feel right now. All we have to do is keep practicing daily. It's a cumulative effect. If you do it today and you don't do it for the next few days and then you start doing it again, it's not going to have the same effects. We have to do it every single day. And it's helpful to incorporate Torah study with this in the study of Kabbalah, especially. Because through studying these Kabbalistic concepts, we learn to yearn for those qualities. And the yearning is what builds the vessel, expands the vessel to receive that light. This yearning, and we're drawing in the surrounding light. Whenever we come to the study of Torah or Kabbalah especially, we need to read the text as if this is the as if we're dying in the next few moments, and the only way to really correct it, the only medicine, is to actually receive this light through the study of the Torah. That's the kind of intention, the intensity that we have to have, because the stronger the desire, the more light, right? We always have to keep a fire burning on the altar. Perpetual fire burning on the altar. And this is one of the hang-ups of wanting to receive for our own pleasure, because once we actually receive it and that desire is fulfilled, the desire is gone. We can no longer use it. And the desire is actually the most important thing when it comes to elevating We can't move anywhere if there's no desire. And movement in the spiritual world doesn't have anything to do with time or distance or motion. It has everything to do with the qualities that we want to attain. And if we have no desire to attain those qualities, which mostly comes through the study of Torah, then we're not moving anywhere. All right, I've blabbed enough. So anybody has any questions or comments, feel free to take the mic or type it into the chat. Yeah, I was originally going to do two meditations for tonight, but I figured this one would be, place all the focus on this one. It's really what it comes down to at the root level. And if we can correct our desires, then everything that follows that will be corrected. What is people around you? Okay, so I think you're asking, what if people don't practice meditation and prayer where you are? Maybe that's what you're asking. So that's still okay, because you've found a group online where you can connect with others, go beyond the level of people, and because we're not connecting. We always have this kind of in the forefront of our minds that we have to be in a physical group, although it does help to be in a physical group. You don't need it as long as you have other souls that you're connecting to, because when we connect in the spiritual world, there's no division. There's no space distance between you. There's no time. We're connecting above that level. We're already connected at that level, actually. All we're doing is bringing an awareness to it. Just kind of tuning in, like finding the right radio station. So it still, that doesn't make it easier. You know, it's always a lot easier whenever you have a physical group to connect with. But like I said, it doesn't really matter. If you have the desire to connect and you have that proper intention, that's all you need. Because even if you're across, you know, all the way across the world, if you and another person share this similar desire, you come close together. You feel that connection, and Hashem is revealed in the connection. All right, does anybody else have any comments or questions?
I was just thinking, Luke, that when we get into, we got two more weeks, we're going to do this, and then we're going to take some time to develop something new, but part of that's going to be meditation. And I think, one of the things probably might do, and there's already stuff like this out there, but maybe in a unique way, is like you said, when you're by yourself, you still can do these things, but maybe post some kind of ideas or something, like a weekly or daily kind of you know, to continue on the theme for the week or whatever, like little things that you can meditate on, just some helpful things for people. Because I think a lot of folks, it's one thing to show up to groups here, you're doing stuff, okay, this is great. But then you get into during the week and we all get busy and all. And of course, we all theoretically or whatever would love to be, you know, oh yeah, I meditate every night at 6 o'clock for, you know, whatever, you know, it doesn't always work that way. But to have some things that we could put together so people could turn to and just, you know, for a little daily guiding type of thing, like, or just a different angle on the theme for the week. You know, it's like, oh yeah, I can meditate on this aspect of it. It's a, you know, something different. So yeah, I think that would be something we'll work on together.
Yeah, it was I kind of have this idea laid out in a notebook from Sefer Yetzirah, where it's like each day has a specific influence that we're trying to draw down and just kind of bring into the world. And at this level where we're connecting, aiming to connect with other souls, I mean, this is what it's all about. And so it's like whenever we first begin meditation, you know, we have these things that we want to try. It's like, I'm gonna meditate and envision the light, you know, or something like that. But the thing is, this is also a intention to receive for myself. So it's like you're still cut off from the connection. And we have to learn the proper intentions. So I think if we did something like that and would, like, you know, be very specific with the intention and creating the meditations and everything, I think it would be really helpful, especially for people who don't have a group. Maybe they have a group online, which is really good. But even if they don't have a group, either physically or whatever, they would still be able to connect to feel that connection to others through these intentions. But that was something we've talked about before. I think do like a 7-day, not like Zoom, but just create the intention through, you know, like a document or something, and just every day somebody would have, you know, like you just said, something to go to, something specific to focus on. That's one of the hardest things. When you first start meditation is you really don't know what to focus on. You're just like, okay, here I am, Hashem, you know. But even that, you know, by itself is good too. Gotta start somewhere. Like, just say we have to go through Lolishma to get to Lishma. I'll end up in the same place.
Explain that last one.
We have to go through Lolishma to get to Lishma. So, like, the idea of we have to start with this intention for ourselves, because without it, we won't ever come to an awareness of the intention for ourselves. So it's like we have to start the practice somewhere. Mm-hmm. And even though we don't necessarily have the awareness yet, it'll come as long as we stay consistent with the practice. And then once it comes, it's like you're not only aware of it, then you can feel it. It's like you can feel that I'm wanting this for myself, and this is what's preventing me from connecting with Hashem, because the connection with Hashem is through others. So it's like the whole love your neighbor as yourself, you know.
That's it's very, very matrixy there, buddy.
Yeah, the path of the one is made of the path of the many.
Well, you just, it's funny because at the second movie at the end, he says, it's different now. I can feel them. It's like he gets to a different level. He gets to a different level. Yeah. Anyhow, so. Yeah, I know. Okay. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thank you. Thank you all. And we're going to do this two more Saturday nights, Lord willing. And then we'll continue just doing something on Saturday nights to keep the momentum going. But we'll be working on a bigger project with incorporating a lot of things. And if anyone wants to help out in any way, you name it, there's something for anybody who wants to be part of that. There's all kinds of things. So just get in touch with yours truly here. But we're looking to connect a lot of different things together in a very unique way. So that's going to be the goal this summer. To list the tasks you need help with. If I knew what they were. No, yeah. Oh, just a lot of it is just Google and researching things. Like, here's some topics and themes, and go out and find great studies, commentaries, quotes, videos, articles, and so on. Just like that kind of stuff to bring into the study part of it, you know. Or the meditative part of it, because there's going to be a study, it's going to be meditation, it's going to be connecting to other things that are out in the world and the not necessarily religious world either. So I was jokingly typed the other day. I said, use a computer, which is probably most everyone reading this. If you can use a computer, you're qualified. Yeah. So, difference between Levites and Kohen. Kohen's priest. So you have the Levites, you have the Kohanim, and then you have the high priest, Kohen Gadol, the big kahuna. Well, the main part of the study, the framework is going to be around Song of Songs, Shir HaShirim. So all of the themes that are in that book, looking for some, there's a lot of different types of commentaries and things out there that are really good. Obviously, I've got a few good ones to start off with. But as we get into it too, just as we start developing some of this stuff, that those tasks will present themselves, you know? So, you know, if we have people ready and waiting kind of thing, you know, that's one aspect of this. Also, when we start connecting other things in our world to those themes, things around us, whether it's in, you know, art or science or whatever, you know, that will be an opportunity to do some research and find things. So more to come, just looking for people to be aware, you know, wanting to be part of it.
If you're so willing, yeah, if somebody's willing to do it, just come to Toby. He knows what to tell you.
Yeah, just, and basically too, just, you know, everybody's, you know, coming at things differently, different experiences. So it's definitely something where it would be good on our end to know what people have access to, or what their background is, what they know, to better, I hate to use the word assign, but, you know, like, okay, if you're good at one thing, I don't want to, you know, suggest a different task that you're not good at or not comfortable with, you know, something like that. So basically, more to come. Just the big thing too is just when we get this thing going, to just people getting involved in any way they see that they can get involved too, you know. It'll present itself. It's just everyone, I'm sure, has something to say, something they know, something they have questions of, something they can research, etc. But it's going to be centered around Shir HaShirim, Song of Songs. So number one, if you haven't read that text in a while, go back and carefully read it. But I would also say to pull up some good kosher commentaries on it that will present some of the deeper ideas to you and get your own mind going on what other themes that you might see or connect. But if you don't know what you're good at, I guess that's when you need to do more meditation. I don't know. Right? Meditate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some soul searching.
Yeah, I think people generally have a better idea of what they're good at than what they first think, you know. It's like, well, what do you like to do? I like to do this. You do it often? Yes, I do. Well, okay, that's probably something you should look at then, you know. Like, I don't like speaking as much as I like writing. I like researching and writing. I'm not comfortable speaking, like, in front of crowds or even doing this that much. This is more challenging for me because my mind just goes all over the place too fast, like, all the time. So, like, I'll get lost in the middle of my own sentence because I start thinking about, oh, maybe I should mention this. And then it's like, oh, what was I saying? You know, it's like I'm not good at the speaking thing. So I'm more of a research and trying to pull different kinds of ideas together that, or take other people's ideas. And I always find, like, recreating or second creation, like somebody invents a device, and now you take that device and you use it to do something no one ever thought of with it. Oh, wow. You know, it's like that kind of thing, you know? So what teachings do you support for study subconscious and conscious relationships? Well, are you, well, I mean, at the spiritual level of things, I guess I could call it that. I only refer people to, you know, traditional Torah Hasidic teachings, unless you're talking about more of a psychological aspect. But even then, you get into like Rabbi Y.Y. Jacobson or Simone Jacobson, but the two brothers, they both touch on these kind of things. Rabbi Daniel Katz, of course, we're a big fan of his. He touches on these things. There's a lot out there that are, you know. Well, yeah, Rabbi Nachman, God, you know, has been, you know, yes, his teachings are brought down. I was thinking of rabbis that are currently making videos, you know, on more modern, you know. Rabbi Label Wolf, he's an LAIBLWOLF, Label Wolf. You'll find his YouTube videos out there. He talks a lot about the psycho-spiritual realm. Psycho-spiritual is a funny word because it's a very accurate word, but it's also a word used in a lot of silly areas that are not what we're talking about, you know, goofy stuff, pop psychology. But no, but it's the bridge between the third and fourth levels, you know, between the intellect, the psychological level of neshama, and the level we're talking about right now. But yeah, so Label Wolf's a good one. Yeah, but you know, there's a lot of good sources that talk
also
about this thing. Go ahead, Luke.
Rabbi Yitzhak Ginsburg, he does, like, this whole psychology of Kabbalah thing.
Yeah. Yeah, him too, yeah. Oh, yeah, he's okay. Yeah, I thought I mentioned him. I guess I didn't, you're right. Ginsburg, the two Jacobson brothers, Daniel Katz, Label Wolf, they all talk about these things connecting the third and fourth levels, you know, the intellect and spiritual levels, because that's where it's at. You know, your mind, you know, that's why, like, Shema Israel, you know, oh, well, let's you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul and strength, but it's understood as your heart, mind and strength, because the neshama, the mind and the intellect, that's where it all connects,
right? Alan, are you familiar with Rob Daniel Katz by chance?
Daniel, DONIELKATZ. Okay. Yeah, maybe you could. We'll put, maybe Luke, you could post a couple videos in the group, in the DevCood group. If you got access, are you in our DevCood group? I take it. If not, you should be. We could post some links to some of his stuff. Highly, highly recommended. He's right on the. There's a lot of good old school rabbis, and I'm not saying anything bad about them at all. But there is also some that have that understanding as well, but have a I think a good understanding of this generation, both literally in terms of the people, but also like this particular generation where we're at, how things are very unique in this generation, very different in many ways, and require different thinking, different solutions. You know, it's just, that's why Torah is flexible.
Rabbi Daniel Katz comes from all of his teachings come from a very experiential level. So like where a majority of the rabbis that you would hear these teachings from, unless they're like actually teaching meditation and things like this, a lot of it comes from just their understanding of the sources, whereas someone like Rav Daniel Katz has experienced this to where he can break it down to exactly, you know, every single level of what you're going to be experiencing through this process. And so I would definitely recommend it. Thank you. Great. Yeah. Lots of good stuff on YouTube for free. His channel, I think it's Elevation. I cannot remember the name of the channel, but it's Elevation something, where it's got like all kinds of videos on there. The ones I would recommend the most is, have it, great. So the ones I would recommend the most is the Primal Hasidus series, and then the, what is it? It's like a three-part video series of Kabbalah and Consciousness. Yeah. But yeah, definitely check that out, because that could be something that, you know, really clicks with you. I know it really clicked with me, so maybe. But yeah, I mean, there's lots of rabbis from the old generation and this generation. But I think, like Tovia said, he's kind of like, he's on that level where he can kind of connect to anyone, and he can meet you where you are and just kind of bring all of this to you in a very simple way.
I'm going to pause the recording here, which I meant to do earlier. No, don't want to end that. I just want to pause the recording. Where is it? Stop recording.